Hello and welcome to a Colorado Rockies podcast. I am currently calling Shades of Purple. This is episode zero, sort of a test run to see how things go. My name is Evan. You may remember me from the unfortunately now defunct Rockies podcast, the Rock Pile Talk Pile. That was the official podcast of r/Colorado Rockies, the Colorado Rockies subreddit. Unfortunately, that podcast has now ceased to be, but I wanted to give myself an avenue to continue talking about the Rockies and give people who want to listen about the Rockies another option for that. Don't really have a format set in stone at this point in time. Like I said, this is episode zero. We're sort of throwing things at the wall to see what sticks. But we have a sort of outline that I'm going to follow here and have lots of things I want to talk about. So if you will join me, let's get started. It's been an interesting offseason, to say the least, for Rockies fans. Lots of things happening. Some things we didn't want to happen did. Other things, departures, new arrivals, things like that. So we're going to start with major offseason changes for the Rockies this season. We're going to start with the fact that free agent Daniel Murphy has retired. Daniel Murphy spent the last two seasons with the Rockies and was just really bad. The bat that he was supposed to be, nowhere near what we have seen from him on a major league level. Career worst numbers in almost every way, shape, and form. Atrocious on defense, mostly playing first base, despite the fact that he had not been a first baseman before signing. Daniel Murphy was a controversial signing for the Rockies because general manager Jeff Bridich and owner Dick Monfort, in a move they later would say that they regretted, let second baseman DJ LeMahieu walk in free agency, and then signed Daniel Murphy to a two-year, $24 million contract. Unfortunately, Murphy really did not deliver at all what we thought he potentially could while he was here, and after hitting free agency at the end of the season, the Rockies paid his $6 million buyout, and he has since retired. The Rockies' non-tendered fan favorites, Tony Wolters and David Dahl. David Dahl was set to earn about $3 million in arbitration coming into the 2021 season. Rockies did not want to pay that, unfortunately, so he was non-tendered in December. David Dahl signed a one-year, $2.7 million contract with the Texas Rangers. That's, I think, a really good fit for him. He's an immediate upgrade in that outfield, and if he can be healthy and ready to go, he, I think, is really going to excel there. I'm definitely sad to see him gone. Tony Wolters, another fan favorite here in Colorado, signed a minor league deal with the Pittsburgh Pirates with a spring training invite. Tony Wolters was also, unfortunately, non-tendered this offseason. Tony Wolters, known particularly for his defense and his repertoire with the pitching staff here with the Rockies, but his offensive numbers never really kept up. He was did not play particularly well at the plate in 2020 during that shortened season. Tony did not hit a single home run. His power numbers have really never been there, but his batting average was alarmingly low. He wasn't really getting the hits that we needed him to get, especially in the bottom of the order where we didn't have a lot of people hitting. Tony's really going to be missed, and I think he definitely makes the roster in Pittsburgh. I'm sad to see him go. But the Rockies are going to see what they have in Elias Diaz, who will now be the starter, and Dom Nunez, who was in the minor leagues last year and was at the Rockies' alternate site. In 2020, Tony batted 230 with an OBP of 280 and a slugging of 270. Just really not where we needed him to be, and that was only 23 hits and 100 at-bats. He put up a negative BWAR of negative 0.3, just unfortunately not the kind of offensive production you need from a catcher in the current league. We are definitely going to miss him, but I can unfortunately see where the front office was coming by this standpoint. Sad to see a fan favorite like Tony go. We wish him luck wherever he goes. Definitely pulling for him to make that roster spot with Pittsburgh. Speaking of catchers, Drew Butera was also not re-signed for the first time in what seems like forever. Drew Butera has joined David Dahl with the Rangers on a minor league contract with a spring training invite. Drew Butera, it never really made sense why he kept getting starts and why he kept getting contracts with the Rockies over the last 3 years. never particularly good in anything that he did. Defensively, not great. Offensively, not great. Just, unfortunately, was sort of a head-scratcher that the front office kept him around. Seems like a good guy, all things considered, but it's time for him to go, and I'm glad that he has. Like I said, our catching battery likely to start is going to be Elias Diaz as the starter with Dom Nunez backing him up. We also saw in 2020 the disastrous super pen that Jeff Bridich put together finally all go their separate ways. Everyone from that bullpen is now gone. Jake McGee signed with the Dodgers last year after getting cut, magically found more velocity, and won himself a World Series ring. He is this year signed with the Giants on a 2-year, $7 million contract, $5 million of that is guaranteed. He's got a club option for 2023. Wade Davis is returned to his home with the Royals on a minor league deal and a spring training invite. You know, I know he was really bad for us, but I definitely hope that he puts it back together with the Royals. He's reunited with former teammate and former Rocky, Greg Holland. And so we wish him the best. And then finally, out of the three, Brian Shaw, who was cut last year, signed with the Seattle Mariners. You may remember him in an interview blaming the Rockies and Coors Field for his disastrous pitching efforts with the Rockies, and where he was one of the worst relievers in the league. He promptly was pretty terrible with the Mariners, was designated for assignment, did not really pick up anywhere else, and elected free agency in October after the season. Shaw is returning to where he was last good with the Cleveland baseball team for this year on a minor league deal and a spring training invite. The issue with Brian Shaw is that as he's getting older, he can't really be the workhorse that he was, especially with the fact that his primary pitch is a cutter, and that cutter doesn't cut. So we saw that a lot of times with both his stint with the Rockies and the Mariners, this cutter would just be a big meatball right down the middle, and he would get crushed. He really, really, really struggled. And if he can put it back together, great. But I'm glad that he's no longer with us, and I'm glad that the experiment of the Super Bullpen is over. It just really, really did not work out. And unfortunately, I think has caused a lot of issues for this team that we'll probably be feeling for years to come here. Those were the last major free agency signings that Jeff Bridich put together. Was Daniel Murphy in the Super Bullpen. Daniel Murphy was the last free agent to be signed. That was in 2018, December 21st. It has been over 2 years since the Colorado Rockies have signed a major league player to a major league contract, and I think we're going to see that continue, especially since Dick Monfort, owner of the Colorado Rockies, has outright stated that we are looking to cut our payroll and admitted in a disastrous press conference that he would not be making efforts to sign big-name free agents. So it's going to be down to our farm system and who we can get on minor league or budget deals, unfortunately. Speaking of the disastrous signings by Jeff Bridich and Dick Monfort, Ian Desmond, first baseman, outfielder, utility guy, stand-up guy all around, has opted out for the 2021 season in order to spend more time with his family and continue his humanitarian work that he started in 2020. Ian Desmond will forego the final year of his contract and salary, capping off what was a 5-year, $70 million contract he signed that unfortunately just really, for lack of a better term, blew up in the team's face. Ian Desmond is a great guy, well-liked in the clubhouse, a great person overall, but his performance on the field left a lot to be desired, and unfortunately it just wasn't worth the money that was spent. And people knew going into it that he probably wasn't going to be worth 5 years, $70 million, but that was the contract that was put in front of him, and you can't blame him for accepting that. And what was really important, I think, for him is that he was a veteran voice of leadership in the clubhouse. Players like Trevor Story and Scott Oberg have talked about his leadership in the dugout and how important that was, and I think that's going to be something that will really, really be missed. So, Desi, if we see you again this year and you choose to opt back in, that'll be great, and we'll be happy to see you in terms of clubhouse presence. But if not, I wish you the best wherever you go. This might be the end of Ian Desmond's major league career. He is in his mid-30s and is now will have not played in two seasons. And unfortunately, I don't think that's going to make him an incredibly appealing player to be signed, unless it's going to be on a cheap minor league deal or something like that. And you never know. He definitely could continue to keep playing. So it's really just we're going to see where the wind takes him on that front. The final major bit of news before the big off-season event that I'll go to in a bit more depth was that the Colorado Rockies traded Jeff Hoffman, the long belagered former prospect, and a 2020 draft pick by the name of Case Williams, who is from Colorado, to the Cincinnati Reds in exchange for right-handed pitcher Robert Stevenson and a prospect outfielder by the name of Jameson Hanna. So Jeff Hoffman, unfortunately, really struggled to be consistent at Coors Field and as a Rocky as a whole, and I think definitely was time to move him to greener pastures and see if he can succeed with a different team, with a different coaching staff. As you might know, Jeff Hoffman was the last remaining piece of the Troy Tulowitzki trade from 2015 to be with the team. There is no longer a single piece of that trade that is still with us. I hope he puts it together. He's got the potential for electric stuff, and he's still very, very young. But with the Rockies, he just could not keep consistent. He bounced back and forth from getting opportunities as a starter to long relief to other bullpen opportunities. He saw his ERA balloon constantly, and it just was not something that he was able to put together while here in Colorado. So Jeff Hoffman, I think, without pitching at altitude, he's got a bit more stuff that can work out. His 2020 season was a disaster. Negative 0.9 BWAR. He had an ERA of 9.28, one of the worst in the majors, and that was only across 21.1 innings, mind you. But, you know, with the shortened season, you can say small sample size all you want, but it's the sample size that we are given. And he's never really been able to put together solid numbers with the Rockies to begin with. He very rarely had an ERA under 5, let alone under 6. In 2009 with the Rockies, he had an ERA of 6.56. In 2018, it was 9.35. In 2017, it was 5.98. And in 2016, his first year with the club, it was 8.33. And this is just a guy who couldn't make it work for him. So he moves on to Cincinnati with Case Williams, a relatively unknown minor league pitcher drafted in the fourth round of the 2020 draft by the Rockies from here in Colorado, a right-handed pitcher. Sad to see a local guy go, but as of this time, it's not really clear that he was much of a valuable piece to be lost. And what the Rockies gain in return in this trade, I think, is interesting to look at. So the main piece of the trade is Robert Stevenson. Robert Stevenson is very much a Jeff Hoffman analog in terms of the Cincinnati Reds organization. His former top prospect, first-round draft pick, who has struggled to put it together, and in 2019, it looked like he finally had. He had an ERA of 3.76 in 64 innings pitched. He had a whip of 1.159, strikeout-to-walk ratio of 2.37. But then in 2020, it sort of all fell apart. In addition to a back injury, he had put up some pretty bad numbers, career worst. Granted, he did not pitch that much. If you're saying Jeff Hoffman's 21 innings are a small sample size, then Stevenson's 10 innings are even smaller. In 10 innings, he put up a negative 0.4 WAR with an ERA of 9.90. Robert Stevenson is a guy I like personally, and I hope he can get it together in terms of coming off of us. The injuries were really hurting him last year. He's a big guy. He's 6'3". He has good velocity and good spin rate on his pitches. His best breaking pitch is a curveball that he can put to great use. I think his pitches might actually work better at Coors Field than Jeff Hoffman's do. So we will definitely see where that goes, and I'm going to be watching him. He's likely going to be on the opening day roster in our bullpen, in our very young bullpen. He's 28 years old, going to be one of the older guys on there, beneath Michael Givens and Scott Oberg. But he is a relatively cheap addition to the bullpen, and we can make sure that if he's not worth it, he can be non-tendered or anything like that. He's still arbitration eligible, and so we'll see where he goes. The second piece in that trade is a 23-year-old outfield prospect named Jameson Hanna. Jameson Hanna is an interesting prospect overall. He's not really played over Class A Advanced. He's, like many others, due to COVID, his 2020 minor league season was non-existent because of the cancellation of the minor league season. He slashed in Class A Advanced 274, 339, and 369, and was the Reds' 15 overall ranked prospect according to the MLB pipeline. Coming into the Rockies organization, he stays about the same. He is the 16th overall ranked prospect in the Rockies according to the MLB pipeline. He is expected to start this season probably in Double-A Hartford. I don't believe he's going to be at spring training this year. He's got good speed. The main thing for Jameson Hanna is that he's got very good speed, but it's interesting to see where he's going to go. He's a slap-hitting contact hitter. Doesn't have much power. His arm is okay. MLB ranks his arm at a 45 and his power at a 45. His hit at a 50 and his running at 60. Fielding at 55. His overall prospect rating is a 45. We've definitely seen better, but the major thing is that his speed is really going to be effective on a young and very fast Rockies team, we're finding out. Especially right now in the major league system and close to the major league system, we've got a lot of very fast guys. Trevor Story is very fast. Garrett Hampson, Yonatan Daza, who might spend some more time with the major league club this year, and of course, Raimel Tapia. So he's another very, very quick young man. He's suited to center field, which the Rockies definitely have sort of a center field problem, especially in their minor league system where we don't have a ton of center field prospects. And he's a solid contact hitter, so if he can get himself on base, then he can make use of that speed. He's not going to get a lot of home runs, but if he can get on base, he can stretch out base hits. And he can be a stealing threat, which is something that I think we'll like to see, especially as we're trying to push for more steals out of our faster guys like we saw the last 2 years. But unfortunately, that leads us to the major piece of off-season news, the major departure from the Rockies during the off-season here, is the trade of All-Star third baseman Nolan Arenado. Nolan, fresh off of his eighth season with us, his eighth consecutive gold glove, his fourth consecutive platinum glove, struggled at the plate in 2020 after a nagging shoulder injury basically shut down his ability to be offensive productively very early in the season against one of the first series of the season against the Oakland Athletics. That nagged him for the rest of the season, and he spent his last bit of time with the Rockies on the injured list. Nolan, however, was still good enough in 2020 to be considered the best defensive player, winning another gold glove and another platinum glove. However, his displeasure with the organization was well known. After signing his contract extension, the organization promised him that they would build around him and build a competitive team, and that is just something that they did not do. The free agent signings have been disastrous, and after Daniel Murphy, they just stopped signing people altogether, choosing instead to stand pat and see where things are at. And I understand that is an approach, but when you are arguing that you are in contention and you have promised your Hall of Fame bound third baseman, one of the best players that has ever worn purple pinstripes, that you are going to build around him to try and win a World Series, the things that the Rockies front office did just won't cut it. And apparently, Nolan requested a trade just 9 months after signing his extension, when it was made clear that the organization was not going to stand by their word. He butted heads publicly with general manager Jeff Bridich, saying that he felt disrespected by the team and by Bridich. And unfortunately, the organization chose to stand by said general manager instead of Nolan, and I find that really disappointing. But what we do know with Nolan is that he wanted out. He made it very clear as such, and we watched sort of trade talks and trade rumors be all over the place for the last year, beginning of the 2020 season, and over this last off season, We heard frequently that Nolan was being targeted by the St. Louis Cardinals, and that is where he ended up. So we traded Nolan to the St. Louis Cardinals for four prospects and a major league player, and we traded him along with $51 million for those players. For what it's worth, Nolan seems happy in St. Louis. The day after he was traded in interviews, he was smiling. He looked happier than we had seen him in any recent interviews here with the Rockies, and that's definitely sad to see, but I think that in the grand scheme of things, this needed to happen, and it was going to happen regardless of whether we wanted it to or not. No one wanted out, and the organization, you know, followed his wishes. The major problem with that is that the return for Nolan Arenado is maybe one of the worst we've ever seen. And so we're going to break that down here in detail for you. The trade for Nolan Arenado was one major league player, left-handed pitcher Austin Gomber. Austin Gomber he's a major league player. He spent time with the Cardinals in 2020, both in the rotation and in the bullpen. He's projected to be a starter in the Rockies rotation this year as our number five starter. He's got solid stuff. He's in a bubble, exactly what the Rockies have needed for the last couple years, a solid number four or number five back end of rotation guy. He's got a strong curveball that I really like, and he's a talented pitcher. He's, you know, 27 years old, and he can definitely be impactful on the team, and he's exactly what we've been wanting as a back end of rotation pitcher for the last couple of years. I just wish it hadn't come at such a great cost. The prospects that we got in return for Nolan as well are unfortunately not really anyone of particular note. The biggest of note is going to be Elijeris Montero. Elijeris Montero is a third base prospect. He was ranked number 8 in the Cardinals organization. He is the only prospect that received from them inside the top 10 organizationally. He's had a couple injuries that have derailed his progress, and he did not play in 2020. Like many other players, it's had his development sort of stunted. Coming to the Rockies, he's immediately the number 7 prospect in our own system. He's a corner infield like a lot of our top 10 prospects are. I believe 6 of our top 10 prospects are corner infielders. He's got a good power bat, but he has shown to not have very good eye or plate discipline. He's got a 30% strikeout rate in his AA debut in 2019. Not particularly fast, not particularly good range or defensively. His footwork needs work at third base, but he's got a good arm. He's got the arm to play first base, and if he can develop his footwork and defensive reads, he can maybe turn into a better third base prospect. But the main thing that he's here for is the power bat and the arm. Honestly, though, I don't really see how Lajeris fits into our organization in terms of overall prospects and development, especially with so many other corner infielders. We've got Colton Welker, who's almost MLB ready, and Colorado's number 6 prospect, Aaron Shunk, is very much likely going to leapfrog him in development this year. He's ranked number 6. He's had consistent playing time, and he's looking to be a very interesting young prospect. And I just think that Montero was not the third base prospect out of the Cardinals that we wanted to go for. The Cardinals had 3 prospects in the MLB's top 100 pipeline listing. One of those is Nolan Gorman, who we did not receive, who is still with the Cardinals. And now that Nolan Arenado is a Cardinal, they're looking to try him in other positions. And he is definitely the player, if not the player in the Cardinals organization that I would have pushed for in trading Nolan, then definitely one of them. They also had Matthew Liberatore and Dylan Carson. Liberatore is a left-handed pitching prospect, originally acquired by the Cardinals from the Rays, and he has electric stuff, and he is definitely who I would have wanted. The issue is that we didn't get any of those top prospects. We didn't get any prospects in the MLB top 100, and Montero is the only one in the Cardinals top 10 organizationally that we received. And that's what makes the $51 million that we added to pay for Nolan to play for the Cardinals next year and the year after so frustrating. Because in a lot of major league trades like this, that $51 million is to pad it so that we can receive better prospects in return. And instead of the haul that we got, we could have maybe gone more value over volume versus I'm very much of the opinion that this trade is much a volume over value trade. Yes, we got five players for Nolan Arenado and $51 million, but none of them are the kind of players that have the worth that would have made Nolan and $51 million a little bit easier to part with. The second prospect in the trade is Mateo Gil. Mateo Gil is the youngest guy in the bunch. He's only 20 years old. He's listed as a third baseman, but he profiles more as a shortstop. He has a quick and accurate throwing arm, very much like Trevor Story, though his arm is definitely weaker. He doesn't really have the arm for the hot corner at this point. He's a good defender. He's known to have very strong baseball IQ, know where the ball is, know where to get it. He's projected majorly as a utility guy. He reminds me a lot of Garrett Hampson. Nick Groke of The Athletic made a similar comment. He is not going to hit for a lot of power. He's a contact hitter with good speed. So he'll get on base, and his plate discipline is improving. Per MLB Pipeline, he's making a lot of good progress at the plate. He's got a keen eye for getting the barrel to the ball. So if he can get the ball in contact, he can be a speed threat. Like I said, very similar to Jameson Hanna and a lot of the other young, speedy guys we've got on this team right now. Not a lot of power paired with that speed, except for Trevor Story. But we have so many guys who can just be so, so fast. And I think that's an interesting direction the team is taking. The next prospect of the bunch is Tony Losey. Tony Losey currently is a starter, but he's projected more to be a bullpen shutdown kind of guy. Coming into the Rockies organization, he ranks himself at number 15 overall. He's a right-handed pitcher. He's a big guy. He's got big pitches. He is 6'3", and he's 239 pounds. He profiles very similarly to Carlos Estevez. He's got a fastball around 94, 96, but has been known to touch 98, and he's can hit 100 if he's working out of the bullpen. 98's more of if he's working on a start or on a more of a stretch length appearance. He's been able to keep his velocity while he's been pitching longer starts, which is definitely great to see. He also is working on a curveball that's promising, though his best pitch is his fastball. The major complaint is that he's got difficulty maintaining command of his pitches and hitting his spots. That's why I think he profiles a lot more as a Carlos Estevez type late game shutdown bullpen kind of guy. Of all the prospects we got in a vacuum, this is the guy I like the most. I like shutdown relievers with powerful fastballs. I think he's got a lot to give, but it's another one of those things where we sort of have to wait and see where he ends up. Losey is potentially could start the year with the Rockies at this point, though his expected time of arrival in the major leagues is likely going to be in next season. The final prospect or player we received in this trade is Jake Summers, another pitcher. There's almost nothing to say about this guy. He's got a good strikeout to walk ratio. He's drafted in 2019. He has no minor league experience due to COVID. He's a total unknown. He's unranked in Colorado. He was unranked in St. Louis. The inclusion of him in this trade really seems like just filler, which is so frustrating when, like I said, this trade was volume over value when with the best third baseman in the league on a Hall of Fame career track, who is the best player to ever come out of the Rockies team, and $51 million gets sent to a competing organization, and this is the return we get. In a bubble, I can definitely see how parts of this trade could work. Like, trying to be positive, there are some really interesting guys in this team. I like Mateo Gil. I like Tony Losey. Austin Gomber can be a great back end of rotation guy, but in exchange for Nolan Arenado, it's just a terrible return. And that's me trying to keep an open mind. But when you're sending Nolan Arenado to the St. Louis Cardinals, who are promising him a World Series ring and a hefty chunk of change, this is not the kind of return you want. You wanted to see at least one of those top 100 prospects. You wanted to see Dylan Carson or Matthew Liberatore or Nolan Gorman, and we didn't see any of those guys. And so I think that's why so many Rockies fans are so frustrated, because not only are we losing a fan favorite player who is one of the best to ever put on the uniform, but we're losing him for so little after a long and drawn out feud with the organization. And it didn't help that the day after the trade, Dick Monfort and Jeff Brinich had a truly disastrous press conference with the media, in which Dick Monfort said things like, I woke up at night thinking the trade didn't make sense. Or Jeff Bridges admitting that he could have gotten more value, but had to settle. And I think another organization with a better front office could have made the trade a little bit more worthwhile. Nolan probably wasn't going to stay a Rocky, and unfortunately that's just what happens in this circumstance. There is a potential that he could have declined to opt out after the 2021 season and stayed with the team to collect his paycheck, but there's also the strong possibility that he wouldn't have. And when you're having a public and drawn out feud with the organization, there are only so many options you have. And for what it's worth, Nolan seems to be fitting in really well in St. Louis. He likes his teammates. He likes the facilities. He's spoken already at length about their coaching staff and getting ready for spring training when he reported to their site in Jupiter, Florida. And for what it's worth, I'm going to miss him a lot. And he seems happy there. I hope he gets his ring. I hope he finds what he wants there. A competitive team that makes an effort and promises its fans to be competitive and makes the moves to do so. So, you know, Nolan, we loved you here in Colorado. We're always going to love you here in Colorado, and we're sad to see you go. After the break, I am going to talk a little bit about spring training, have some other things to break down, and we'll talk to you after that. Hey, welcome back to Shades of Purple, Episode 0. We took care of all the heavy stuff in the first half. For the second half, we're going to be talking about spring training, which is finally here. Pitchers and catchers reported last week. Full squads are now together. The Rockies have fully reported to Salt River Fields and Talking Stick, just outside of Scottsdale. And the first game of spring training is going to be here shortly. So, without further ado, we're going to talk about what we're looking at here in spring training as a precursor to the 2021 season. And the storyline that probably most people are familiar with is going to be the battle for the first base position. We haven't really had a clear-cut first base starter since Todd Helton retired in 2014. We've had multiple stopgaps and people we've tried. We've tried converting Ian Desmond and Daniel Murphy, and none of it's really worked out. And this year, we have an actual battle for who's going to be the starting first baseman. It's not going to be Ryan McMahon, who is moving over to his natural position at third base in the wake of Nolan's departure to St. Louis. Instead, there are three people gunning for that starting position. First up is Josh Fuentes. Nolan Arenado's cousin, Josh Fuentes, really struck out on his own in the 2020 season, becoming the starting first baseman for the majority of the latter half of the season after Daniel Murphy was finally and mercifully benched. Fuentes is now a two-year veteran in the league. In 2020, he posted a 1.1 BWAR and really slashed a phenomenal .306 batting average with an OBP of .320 and slugged .439. He looked much improved, and his defense at first base was just such a refreshing breath of fresh air compared to how Daniel Murphy had been playing at the position. But he's not without competition. Josh Fuentes may seem like the first guy, but he does naturally play third base. They've brought in two first basemen to compete with him on minor league deals, the first of which is Colorado native Greg Bird. Formerly with the New York Yankees, Greg Bird has had a lot of injury history and has just really sort of failed to strike out on his own while he was with the Yankees. He really struggled. He never hit over 200. Greg Bird did not have a season where he was the full-time starter. The most games he's ever played in a season is 82. He is hoping to make a spot on the roster here. But personally, I don't think he's going to make it. It would be a nice story if he did, but I think he's just too inconsistent and struggles too much with injuries. To be the guy. And if he makes the roster, I think it's going to be in a platoon role or as somebody's backup. However, I think the most likely spot for him is that he's either going to get cut or he's going to be on the minor league roster as a depth piece. The guy who I really want to talk about is CJ Krohn. CJ Krohn's sort of a journeyman at this point. He's the oldest of the bunch at 31 years old. Started his career with the Los Angeles Angels, had a short stint with the Rays and the Twins, most recently was with the Detroit Tigers, and now he's come to us on a minor league deal with a spring training invite. CJ Krohn I like for a couple reasons. One, outside of people not really having a lot of bad things to say about the guy. Two, he's got experience as a starter. The most games he's played is 140, so that could clearly be stretched out. But what I really like about CJ Krohn is that, unlike a lot of the other guys we've tried to bring in, he is a career first baseman. That is the only position he plays. That is the only position he knows. He's been a designated hitter during his time in the American League, but when he is starting and he is on the field defensively, he's a first baseman. He's got solid defensive first baseman skills, and he's got really solid power in his bat. Now, last year, he was a little bit all over the place, which I think is why he ended up being to us on a minor league deal. He's didn't have as much power in his bat last year. He only hit 4 home runs, but very, very shortened season in which he only played 13 games in Detroit as Detroit was trying different things with different players. The main seasons I want to look at for him are his 2018 season with the Rays and his 2019 season with the Twins. With the Rays, he played in 140 games and he slashed .253, .323, and .493 with an OPS of .816, but he hit 30 home runs. And then in 2019 with the Minnesota Twins, in 125 games, he hit 25 home runs and still batting average of .253. OBP went down to .311 and his slugging went down to .469. However, he did play less games that season. I think of all the players who are going to make the roster, CJ Krohn is going to be the most likely one there. And I think he puts up a lot of competition with Josh Fuentes for the role. Now, Josh was really solid last season with us at first base, but he doesn't have the same power in his bat that CJ Krohn does. Granted, he's had less of an opportunity. In 2019, he only played 24 games with 56 plate appearances, and in 2020, it was 30 games with 103. But in those seasons, respectively, he hit 3 home runs and 2 home runs. However, his batting average took a huge leap forward. So the question is, can Josh Fuentes keep that pace up while also improving on his power? I think that's really important for someone playing first base with this team and something we haven't really had consistently since Todd Helton retired. I think the most likely scenario is that CJ Krohn is going to win that starting first baseman spot. But Josh Fuentes will be on the opening day roster. I think it's going to be an opportunity for Bud Black to test his versatility. He's likely going to back up first base and third base and maybe be played around in other different spots. I've heard talk about trying him out in left field and seeing how he does there. However, I really do think he's going to end up being more of a platoon depth piece or backup feature instead of the starter at first base. But maybe he does win that first base position. It's wide open, I think, and there's going to be a decent competition this year. That's why it's one of the major storylines for the Rockies going into spring training. And honestly, I think I'll be happy with either Josh Fuentes or CJ Krohn taking that spot. What's interesting about CJ Krohn is that he said that he had offers from other teams, but he turned them down because he felt like the Rockies gave him the best chance to be an everyday contributor and earn that starting first base role. And I think that's something that I want to look out for in him, because I think he can be a good starting first baseman. CJ Krohn is actually a player that I wanted to pick up over the last couple of years, and we just never really got our hands on him. And I'm really happy that he's with the team now on a cheap minor league deal, but I just wish it hadn't come at a time of such turbulence within the organization. either way, I think the battle for first base is going to be really interesting to watch as we move forward throughout spring training. We'll probably see a couple other players bounce around at first base and see how they do. I know Colton Welker is going to be at spring training this year, but the main grouping of people who are aiming for that starting spot are going to be Fuentes, Cron, and Bird. And like I said, Greg Bird is a really likable guy. It's awesome that he's from the state of Colorado. But I just don't see him winning that spot, especially with his history and his lack of consistency with the playing time he has managed to get when he was with the Yankees. But maybe I'll be surprised. That's the hope at the very least. He's certainly a guy to watch during spring training, but there are so many other players to watch as well. And with those players to watch, the first guy I want to talk about is Ryan Rollison. Ryan Rollison is the number two ranked prospect in the Rockies farm system by MLB Pipeline, and it's easy to see why. Despite the fact that he's never played above Advanced A, he was thought to be a potential call-up last year when the Rockies were struggling with rotational depth, especially with John Gray being injured and not really having a number five starter locked down, especially in the middle of the season. We were messing around with Chichi Gonzalez, Ryan Castellani, and basically whoever else we could start in order to fill that void. So Rollison's never pitched above Advanced A. However, their Rockies do have somewhat of an odd precedent to skip phases in pitcher development if they think they're ready to go. We saw this with Antonio Senzatela a couple years ago when he made his Major League debut. Senzatela had never played in AAA. He had never played above AA Hartford. And he's had some ups and downs, but he had such a glowing 2020 season that I'm interested to see how he is, and he's definitely cemented his opportunity in the rotation. Now, with Rollison, it's a little bit murkier because he not playing above double A is not the same as not playing above single A, but he's a very highly rated prospect within our organization for a reason. He was drafted in 2018 in the first round, 22nd overall, and MLB Pipeline ranks him at an overall grade of 50, with a 55 fastball, a 50 slider, control of 55, a 60 curveball, and a 55 changeup. That curveball really is his plus pitch. It's his best pitch, and he's really been tightening his control of that while he's been advancing through the minors, and his slider is fairly good as well. His fastball he has good command of, but it sits low 90s, so it's really going to be that curveball that gets him through the day in terms of his plus pitch. Rollison has had some struggles while he was in minor leagues, but the Rockies organization has been really, really happy with his development, and they've praised him a lot for how he's kept himself going and picked himself back up from these struggles. And I think he's going to definitely make that next step pretty soon. He got an invite to spring training, and we're going to get to see how he does against major league players. I'm really, really excited to watch how he does. However, I do not think he makes the opening day roster. The rotation for opening day is pretty much set in stone at this point, unless someone really surprises us with Airman Marquez, Kyle Freeland, Antonio Senzatela, John Gray, and now Austin Gomber having that number five spot be his to lose. However, I do think we see Rollison as a late September call-up in 2021. There is a potential for seeing him earlier if we deal John Gray at the trade deadline or something like that. But all things considered, I think it's most likely we see him at the end of 2021, and he starts the season either in AA Hartford or he leapfrogs AA and goes straight to AAA Albuquerque. Either way, he's going to be great to watch during spring training this year. I hope everybody gets a chance to take a look and see what stuff he's got. I really do think he's going to be a great future piece for this organization. Speaking of future pieces and highly ranked prospects, though, brings us to Brendan Rodgers. And I really think Brendan Rodgers, this is going to be his do-or-die year in terms of him being a part of this organization going forward. Rodgers was the number one ranked Rockies prospect for five straight years. He has graduated out of being a prospect and out of being a rookie due to playing time. He has not really played that much, though, in terms of his overall play time in 2019 and 2020. Both were cut short by injuries to the same shoulder, which he had season-ending surgery on in 2019, and then in 2020 they shut him down for the season as well. So he's only played 32 total games, but that's enough for him to have sort of aged out. He's 24 years old, so he's still fairly young, but he just is not ranked as a prospect anymore. And the problem is that in the time he has played, he has really not wowed. And granted that it's such a small, small sample size, he has 97 at-bats in his very brief stint as a major leaguer, but put together a BWAR of -1.0, a batting average of only 1.96, and an OBP of 235, slugging 227. He's yet to hit a single home run as a major leaguer, and it's just really been a little concerning, because this is a guy who, when in AAA, we were all thinking, okay, he's got to be ready. But then he wasn't ready. And this was an issue, especially with DJ LeMahieu leaving, because the whole point of letting DJ LeMahieu walk, allegedly, was because Brendan Rodgers was ready to go and he would start at second base. But then he was not ready to go, and the Rockies signed Daniel Murphy instead. This is the year, though, that Brendan Rodgers really needs to prove that he's got what it takes to be a major league ball player. Over everything, he's got to stay healthy, especially with that shoulder. But he needs to put together consistent at-bats, and he needs to show some of the power that we've seen him show in the minor leagues. We know he can do it. We've seen him do it. And he's going to, I think, be starting at second base this season, because the Rockies need to do everything they can to get as much playing time out of him as possible. That way they can see if he really is going to be the guy moving forward, or if we're going to have to start looking elsewhere, especially with the idea of Trevor Story potentially leaving after the 2021 season. Rodgers is a second baseman and shortstop. Righty bat, throws righty. He is medium-sized build. He's about 6 foot, and he's 204 pounds. You've seen him play. He kind of looks like a baby Charlie Blackman with his beard and mullet out there. But it really is that he needs to take a step forward at the plate. His defense at second and short is sort of a known quantity. He doesn't have the best arm, but he's got solid baseball IQ and can make those plays where he needs him to. Jeff Breidich and Dick Monfort talked about this offseason, but potentially playing him at third base, which I don't think is going to come very well to him, especially because he's lacking that arm strength. He really does his best work as a middle infielder. And so I think that's where they're going to keep him. My thoughts on Rodgers is that he will be able to turn it around, or at least I sure hope so, and he's going to be, after spring training, the Rockies' starting second baseman. We've got to get him that playing time, and we've got to see if he's the guy moving forward. Because playing time is so, so important, because when they get enough playing time, we can see if they really do have that potential. And that's something we've seen in Raimel Tapia. Raimel Tapia earned a starting spot and the leadoff spot in the 2020 season. And granted, shortened season, but in that season, he put up his best numbers. He slashed .321, .369, .402 with an OPS of .772. He cut down on his strikeouts, which is really important to see. He had a career low strikeout percentage of 18.5%, and he also started taking more walks with a walk percentage of 6.8%. And I think a lot of this has to do with him slightly retooling his batting stance and swing. What he's doing now, which is really interesting to watch, is he starts the at-bat or the swing with his upper body turned pretty far forward towards the pitcher's mound. And I think this is helping him watch and take pitches better, see what's coming. Because then when the pitch is coming and he's locked in, he'll turn back around and then start his swing. But whatever it is he's done, it really has worked for him. Still not is going to hit for a lot of power. He only had one home run in 2020. His career high in 2019 was 9 home runs. But he really has cemented himself as having earned a starting spot in the outfield. Likely going to be left field, though with his speed he could comfortably play center. However, his defensive skills still need a little bit of work. He is the real question, though, of now that we've seen him excel like this, can he keep it up? And if he can keep it up, I really think he's going to be a great piece of the Rockies' future moving forward. He's young, he's incredibly likable, and he's incredibly talented. And I think if we can put that to good use, the Rockies are looking pretty solid in the outfield. And he can be the leader of this new, younger group of guys. Another young guy we need to see if he can keep it up is Antonio Senzatela. Antonio Senzatela was excellent in 2020. Posted an ERA at Coors of 2.10, by far the best in the team, had a team best ERA of 3.34, leagues above everybody else, higher than even Daniel Bards, who was the second best at, I believe it was 3.72. Antonio Senzatela put a BUR up of 2.8, which was good for fifth best league overall. He looked so improved. His fastball looked better. His breaking pitches were improved. He's been developing that curve, slider, and changer. He looked like a completely different pitcher compared to how he was in 2019, where we were joking that he really couldn't buy a strikeout. His strikeout rate went way up. His walk rate went way down. And he's another guy where he is so young. He's only 25 years old. If he can prove this year that he can keep that up, he is going to be a linchpin of this rotation going forward. And that is such a promising thing that we've got such young, promising starting rotation guys that we can have that to look forward to for the future. Even if John Gray is not necessarily with us, Airman Marquez is still very young. Kyle Freeland is still very young. Antonio Senzatela is still very young. Austin Gomber is only 27. This rotation is young, but they are proving that they can be excellent, even at Coors Field. And that's the one thing I've been really happy with at this organization, is home-growing pitchers who can pitch at altitude and can pitch elsewhere and show that kind of promise and drive and excellence that we can admire, which is something that we really haven't had. There are plenty of Rockies pitchers in history who have been able to be good, but having an entire rotation be able to be good at altitude and elsewhere is really, really important for the future of this organization overall. And so I'm looking forward to seeing how Antonio Senzatela does in 2021. I hope he continues to grow and develop on his excellent 2020 season. He's one of my favorite players in this organization. I've been following him since he was in the minors. I loved that he made that leap over AAA from AA Hartford to get here. He's such a likable guy. He's incredibly nice. I am always, always, always pulling for him. And since we're talking about pitchers in the rotation, we got to talk about who is catching for them. Tony Wolters is unfortunately gone, as is Drew Butera. Our catching battery this year is going to be Elias Diaz and Dom Nunez. Elias Diaz hit 2 home runs last year, more than any set of Rockies catchers have combined in 2020, and that included Tony Wolters and Drew Butera. He's got the power behind the plate. He's a solid pitch framer. He's got a decent pop rate. He can be a really good major league catcher, I think. But the real question is, he only started in 13 games in 2020. Is that enough to really say he's cemented himself as the starting role, especially taking over for Tony Wolters, who defensively, that's some big shoes to fill. Backing up Diaz is going to be Dom Nunez, younger guy, age 26. Never really wowed so far in what opportunities he's had with the big league club, but he hasn't really had that much of an opportunity to begin with. He got 39 at-bats in 2019, posting a negative 0.2 war, slashing 179 with 233 and 410. Never been much of a plus hitter in his career so far, even in the minors. Very rarely hits over 280. But he does have a little bit of pop potential. In 2019, he had 17 home runs with Albuquerque. However, that is a more hitters-friendly league. But he does have that potential, and it's really going to be something he needs to put together if he wants to cement a future with this organization. I think it really is going to be important this year, I hate to say it, that he earn in spring training his opportunity to be the backup catcher, especially when Jose Briseño and Willie McIver are going to be in there in camp. I don't think Chris Rabago or Brian Servin are really going to have shots at earning that backup role, so currently it really is Dom Nunez's to lose, but he's got to make it look like he belongs out there, so that way he can spend time with the big league club, get more at-bats, and we can really see where he's going in terms of his career development, especially when the Rockies have top prospect Drew Romo now in the wings and working on his development in order to come up and be our next future catcher. Dom Nunez I really like, and I hope he does well, but catcher's always such a nebulous position for the Rockies. We really haven't had an all-star catcher ever. Probably the greatest catcher in Rockies franchise history is going to be Jeff Reed, and most people listening to this will probably go, who's that? So Drew Romo is really going to be the guy who we're looking to come up and take the starting catcher position with. But in the meantime, having solid people as that stopgap is really important, and I want Dom Nunez to be, at the very least, a solid backup catcher. And if he's not, then that's definitely a position that we need to fill until Drew Romo is ready to go. Other people to look out for in spring training, let's start with the 26-year-old left-handed reliever Ben Bowden. Ben is ranked as the number 11 prospect in the Rockies organization per MLB pipeline. He's got a really interesting fastball with a late arm side run, really interesting to watch. He was great in Double A Hartford, he was great in Single A and Double A, but when he got to Albuquerque, he really, really struggled. He put up a 5.88 ERA with a 1.76 whip in 26 innings across 22 appearances. However, 2019 in Albuquerque was when they were playing with the major league ball that was quote-unquote juiced ball, and the PCL that year was a hitter's paradise. Tons of home runs, tons of runs being scored. So it's not necessarily fair to judge Ben Bowden on that point, but it's something you want to be careful with all the same, especially when he blew his appearance in the, you know, one-off but still national stage futures game at the All-Star game in 2019. He was actually potentially expected to be in the bullpen in 2020, but during spring training he had a back injury reoccur that shut him down. He was eventually placed in the Rockies alternate site, but then re-aggravated the same back injury and it shut him down again, so he did not pitch at all in 2021. So in spring training this year, his main thing is going to prove that he's healthy, that his back is healed, and he's ready to go, and I really think that bullpen spot is his to gain. He's a lefty, and we really need lefty relievers, something we definitely lack in this bullpen, and he's a young guy who you really want to see succeed as the number 11 prospect in the Rockies farm system. In regards to relievers, the other guy we want to watch out for is Scott Oberg, making his triumphant return after not pitching in 2020 and being shut down at the end of 2019 for career-threatening blood clots in his throwing arm. He went and had surgery in his throwing arm to try and reduce the clots or solve that issue. I really hope that's the case. Scott Oberg has been excellent coming into his own as a late reliever and potential closer for the organization. We definitely missed him in our bullpen in 2020, where the bullpen really, really struggled. He's viewed as a leader, him and Trevor Story, often speaking with Ian Desmond to try and keep the team together and going strong. Scott Oberg is really, really well liked within the organization, and I am really excited to see him back. Definitely, definitely missed him, and I hope that he succeeds in 2021, picking right back where he left off in late 2018 and the beginning of 2019. And that about does it for the people I want to talk about in spring training. I have a roster projection of who I think is going to be starting and where when we hit the beginning of the season. In terms of positional players, I think first base is going to be CJ Cron. Second base is going to be Brendan Rodgers. At shortstop, Trevor Story will have the start for the season. We don't know if he will stay the whole season with us, but I know that he will at least be starting at shortstop. Third base is going to be Ryan McMahon. Catcher behind the plate is going to be Elias Diaz with Dom Nunez backing him up. I think he will win that backup role. In the outfield, I think Raimel Tapia is going to be starting in left field, and Garrett Hampson is going to end up getting the nod as the starting center fielder. He really proved that he can be a solid defensive center fielder last year in multiple starts in center, and I think he's going to be a big part of the team moving forward. And right field is obviously going to be Charlie Blackman. The rotation, number one is going to be Airman Marquez with Kyle Freeland in the number two spot. I think Antonio Senzatela moves up to the number three spot in the rotation. John Gray is going to start the season at number four. He's looked healthy so far in what we've seen of him after just being miserable in 2020. He was hurt, nothing was working, and he eventually was shut down. I think John Gray will rebound. It remains to be seen where he will end the season with. This is his final year on contract with the Rockies before he hits free agency. The Rockies may try and re-sign him, or they may try and trade him to recoup value at the deadline, unknown at this time. And then I think the number five spot is going to be Austin Gomber, that headlining piece in the Nolan Arenado trade. But I could be completely wrong about all of this. Sam Hilliard is in the mix for an outfield starting spot. Josh Fuentes is also in the mix for an infield starting spot, notably at first base, though depending on spring training performances, he could supplant Ryan McMahon as the starting third baseman. You never really know in this scenario, especially when the team's had a major, major shakeup in terms of losing that linchpin in Nolan Arenado. So we will definitely see. First spring training game is coming up soon. I'm really excited to have the guys back on the field. It's going to be really nice to be able to watch baseball again. And that brings me into the next point I want to talk about. And for the most part so far, I've been going off of an outline, had everything planned. But for here, I'm sort of going to be flying off the cuff. And I want to talk about having hope. I want to talk about boycotts. And I want to talk about support. Because here is the deal. I have, on social media, been watching people's reactions to the Nolan Arenado trade and their projections for the 21 season. And honestly, it's, to me, a little ridiculous what some people are saying. I've had people saying that the Rockies are going to win less than 20 games, which would make them the single worst team in Major League Baseball history, worse than the 1899 Cleveland Spiders. No team since 1904 has lost under 30 games. No team since the 30s has lost under 40 games. Will the Rockies probably lose a lot of games this year? Yeah, maybe. It's really tough to say, especially after losing Nolan Arenado. But you cannot logically argue that the Rockies will be the worst team in the history of professional baseball because we lost Nolan. We have four, potentially five, very good starting pitchers. We still have Trevor Story. We still have Charlie Blackmon. We have a lot of young guys who are hungry to prove where they fit in this organization now that Nolan is gone. And those players deserve your support. And I'm not saying this means you have to buy as many tickets as you can. I'm not saying you have to even support the front office. I understand being angry at Jeff Bridich. I understand being angry at Dick Monfort. I even understand being a little angry at Nolan because he wanted out. But the players who do not deserve your anger are the ones who are still here and the ones who are doing their job, which is to play as hard as they can and try and win as many games as possible. I have no idea what the Rockies' record is going to be in 2021. We could lose 100 games. We could potentially not lose 100 games. We could maybe be better than everyone is suspecting. Charlie Blackmon says that he thinks this team is better than a lot of people are giving them credit for. And I think that's a fair assessment. He's definitely a guy who's going to know the team better than a lot of people looking in. But it's okay to have hope. It's okay to hope that the Rockies are going to be good this year. It's okay to hope that Brendan Rodgers is going to show that he's got what it takes to be a major league ball player. It's okay to hope that the Rockies could make the wild card, or that the Rockies could at least not be one of the worst teams in the league. Do you really think the Rockies are going to be worse than the Orioles or than the Pirates? It's okay to be hopeful. And it's okay to support your players and your team. You can go on social media and tweet about your favorite players and root for your favorite players. Tell your friends about Ryan McMahon. Root for Aaron Marquez. You don't have to buy tickets or merchandise to support your team. You don't have to, if you're viewing it as, if I buy tickets or if I buy merch, I'm putting that money directly into Dick Monfort's pocket and I don't want to support that. That's okay. That doesn't mean that you have to stop being a Rockies fan or stop supporting the team overall. And I've had friends flat out say, this year I'm not supporting the Rockies. And I've had friends say, I'm done forever after this. And I totally understand those points of view. This has been an unpleasant offseason that was finalized by a really, really painful departure of a fan favorite player, one of the best players to ever play for this team. But at the same time, I don't want to hear people who have sworn off of the Rockies be angry or upset about those who can't or won't. Because like I said, it is okay to be hopeful. It's okay to continue supporting your team and your players. That doesn't mean anything in terms of ticket sales or merchandise sales or stadium concessions. It is about you and your feelings and how you feel about these players who are working their hardest to deliver a winning baseball product on the field. And I think this very young team that has concerns about where the future is headed for them, there's a lot of question marks. I think they deserve to know that people are behind them and that despite it all, they have fans. They have people that appreciate them. Charlie Blackmon is still here and we still love him and his beard, and he's going to be bringing his big dad energy to the club every single day this season. Trevor Story knows that his future with the Rockies is in question, but that doesn't mean he's going to play any less hard this season to try and win games. Ryan McMahon's going to be trying his best to show who he is as a ball player. Not is he the new Nolan, it is going to be who is Ryan McMahon? What kind of big league player is he? And I think that deserves your support. These guys are doing what they love, playing baseball, and they are doing it for both themselves and for you. And I think that's so important that you don't overlook that. That no matter how angry you get at the team or at the front office or at these baffling decisions that they make for who they traded for Nolan, for who they signed, the contracts that they give out, at the end of the day, it's still a Major League Baseball team who the players, they don't want to lose. They don't want you to feel bad about them. They want to win. Every player wants to win a World Series. Every player wants to succeed. Every player wants to be a Hall of Famer. They're not going to, now that Nolan's gone, just bum around on the field for 9 innings, not trying at all. So why not at least give them the benefit of the doubt that they are doing their very best to deliver an entertaining and competitive baseball product on the field, even if the front office might not be. I want to thank you guys all for listening to this episode zero of Shades of Purple. I have never done a solo podcast before, so I think it could be a little hit or miss on where we're at. Tell me in the comments what you think I could improve upon or what you would like to see. Should I be more stat heavy? Should I go more numbers? Who do you want to hear about? Who do you want to hear me talk about? Do you want guests? Do you want it to continue to be just me? Do you think the name is terrible? Anything like that. I want to give a huge, huge shout out to Brandon Perna of That's Good Sports at Brandon Perna on Twitter for giving me a little encouragement push on Twitter the other day to just go ahead and do it. He said, if I really want to do a podcast, then I should just do it. And I had been feeling a little hesitant just because I wasn't sure, you know, if I would be able to. But I want to put that attempt out here, and that's what this is. And I want to thank you so, so much for listening. I'm super receptive to any criticism, constructive or otherwise, that you might have for me. Feel free to leave it in the comments down below. General goal, if this show continues, if people seem to like it, is to do weekly or bi-weekly, depending on how things go and how my schedule works out. But I definitely want to keep putting this out there. I like making my voice heard about the Rockies, and I like having an outlet for people to listen about the Rockies. Because at the end of the day, as much as I fuss and gripe and complain, the Rockies are still my favorite team in the world. Coors Field is my favorite place in the world. Baseball is my favorite sport in the world, and any opportunity that I get to talk about it is something that I will cherish. So until next time, thank you so much, and best wishes.
Check swing roller. Tulowitzki. Colorado's the National League champion.